And it looks like I did have a microphone muted, so sorry if you guys are sitting in silence for a little bit there. I'm not gonna mess with that button anymore, and we'll just take it from the top, I suppose. Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to a joinDOTA presentation of the MLG Pro League Season 2. This is Root Gaming versus Void Boys, game number 2 of a best of 3. And looking at these guys here, it's Root that are leading 1-0. They're looking really good. They had a kind of intelligence carry type action coming out from game number 1, and looking forward to see what they bring to game 2. Now, Void Boys are picking up the gyrocopter once again. Fly was running a support gyrocopter in the last game, but I do believe that you could easily run it as a carry, and it's kind of that flex pick that you're able to kind of have a variable option of, do we want to carry gyrocopter, do we want to support, kind of pick it reactively based on the draft ahead of you. So we'll see how that plays out. Root Gaming, though, they pick up the Leshrac and the Lina together, and that screams to me that they're going to have another support in conjunction with either one of those. They can run the Lina as a mid, they can run the Leshrac as a core, but they probably won't run them both as supports together. Their stuns just don't really... They're pretty much the same thing. A stun that needs the setup of another disable. The Lightning Storm slow is good, but it's not ideal for that kind of ganking initiation, and I think they'll look for something more like the Shadow Demon themselves. So we saw that work do pretty good work last game, and we'll see what they want to go with. But for now, the bans are initially the Wisp and Shadow Fiend, the Visage and the Queen of Pain, and the Clockwork and Spearbreaker now. So they know that Root Gaming has first pick in Phase 2. We'll see what they don't want to have to deal with in that regard. Thanks once again for tuning in here to join Dota's MLG livestream. If you guys don't recognize my voice, that's because I'm new to broadcasting on it. I myself am Blaze, and having a pretty good time. I was co-casting with F4L. I'm going to have another NA Pro come on in for the next couple of games, but for now, one game of solo won't hurt anybody, and we'll see how that plays out.
5 seconds remaining.
So, going to see the Tide banned out. It's interesting that Void Boys don't want to deal with a Tide at all. They know that Root Gaming are going to be picking that up if in the first of Phase 2, possibly. So, they're going to ban it out. And it looks like they just really are worried about the magical disables. They know that not everybody can go for a BKB. It's a lot weaker item in this patch in general. And, yeah, it seems like that's what they're the most concerned about. The Anchor Smash obviously goes through BKB. And, yeah, in general, it's just a very difficult offlaner to kind of zone out with the Kraken Shell and such. Shadow Demon is going to be the selection for Root Gaming, as I was saying. So, I mean, Lina, Leshrac, they're aided a lot by the Shadow Demon setup. Disruption enables the combo stun, so that works out pretty well. And... yeah, I think there's going to be some good roaming duo potential. Maybe the Shadow Demon Lina will roam from lane to lane with Smoke of Deceit, with Boots, Speed, and some clarities in between, just to make sure they always can make those plays happen. Because Zeus is actually pretty slow as far as trying to respond to an offensive disruption. He usually gets picked off in a lot of those ganks if they get the good flanking opportunity. It means that if they don't specifically see Shadow Demon or Lina for more than even 10 seconds, Zeus has to be on the top of his steps, away from the river, making sure that he doesn't get caught out. One disruption pretty much means his death. He's just not tanky. He's not all that fast. He really has to watch himself. So we're going to be looking at that fourth pickup here for Root Gaming. They see the Nyx Assassin on the field. They know that it could very well be the offlaner selection for Void Boys, and they want to make sure that they have the best response here. Nyx Assassin, no matter how he's run, support, offlaner, I don't think solo mid's a thing anymore, but it once was. But no matter the case, I think that it's really good against Intelligence Heroes. The mana burn is going to scale really well here, and Nyx Assassin, he's going to be pretty level dependent, so that's why I think they're probably going to put him in the offlane. He's just trying to get him as much experience as possible. If he goes for the ice build, which is actually two mangoes, then he's able to run like 4.5-5 HP regen very early on in the game, and it's actually really good. Because he also needs the mana. Like, there's plenty of times where you're in Vendetta, or you have enough mana for Vendetta, but you don't have enough mana for a spell in addition, and your ganks fail as a result of that. But you get the mangoes, your HP regen is so insane you can't be zoned out. You can only be killed 100% to zero. And then, of course, you look for the fact that you can just kind of drain the support's funds. Where Lina, as a support, wants to go for something like a Yule Scepter very early on and set up her own stuns without the Shadow Demon's assistance, the Nyx Assassin forces you to buy Dust and Sentries all over the place, and it's just a tax that you have to pay against these Invis heroes. So Nyx Assassin generally pretty good with his tempo, and can dominate the lower HP, lower armor supports like the Lina if she doesn't have assistance. But interestingly enough, Root, to go through some extended discussion, break down the reserve time down to 6 seconds, and here they come up with a plan. And that plan is run Broodmother into Zeus Gyrocopter. I don't know what the Gyrocopter is going to bring as far as what role he's playing, but I feel that Void Boys have enough flexible lanes that they can respond pretty well to this Broodmother pick. Still, Broodmother in general, as a space creator, is really powerful, and she can dominate games. If they have confidence in Monkeys Forever, maybe him manipulating the flow of battle like we saw with his Puck, then Broodmother can do a lot of work here. However, I'm just going to say, with the detection that they already have from the Zeus, the AoE potential they have from both the Zeus and the Gyrocopter, I would have to say that this is not a guaranteed advantage in terms of the draft. Like, Broodmother can do work here, but I would actually say it's like a 40-60 matchup for her, just from what we see so far. But that depends on Void Boy's next couple of pieces. They may have their Bishop and their Rook, but we'll see what Knight they bring in to kind of address this Broodmother strat most likely. So, could be interesting. If Void Boys wanted to run an aggro try, they'd have to pick up something like a Darkseer, a Sand King, no Tide, obviously. But Ember Spirit's not too bad either. Shadow Fiend has proven himself, but obviously he's been banned out. A lot of different possibilities. And Bristleback's going to be actually their selection of choice. Now, I've seen this actually work out pretty well in a few games where they just run the Bristleback and he's able to get a few good quill sprays off, and if he has the mana to support it, he can get a lot of Spiderite kills, and that's going to give him a nice bit of momentum into the mid game. So I have seen situations where you can just leave the Bristleback in the safe lane solo and roam actively to respond to your mid game threats. Because I think the idea of the Broodmother in this draft is essentially they look at it and say, okay, well, if your supports are so focused on killing this Broodmother top, and she dies 3 or 4 times, so be it. As long as we get openings to move in with Shadow Demon Lina, roam onto the Zeus and kill him off a bunch, that works fine for us. And I think that's overall their general game plan this game, is just create space, find openings, and carry from there. But what carry that will be is going to be a different question entirely. Is it going to be a one-position Leshrac? Is it going to be a mid Leshrac and a one-position right-clicker? They could go for the Axe again if they really feel confident in their ability to snowball this game. Axe is actually really good here, considering he's up against the Nyx Assassin, the Bristleback. Not that great against Zeus, puts his Blink Dagger on cooldown, and the Gyrocopter, of course, if it's a core, would be using Flak Cannon to hit everybody else, no matter if he's called or not. But they go for the Anti-Mage. They go for a one position that's a little bit more reserved. It worked pretty well last time. Mu seemed pretty confident on it, so he'll go here and he'll see what he can accomplish. I mean, he doesn't have the best survivability against the Bristleback Gyrocopter if they're laying in right-clicks into him, but he's not going to be bolted down by the Zeus. The Nyx Assassin would have to perfectly disable him. In general, I think this is a pretty strong pick, and it's all about, again, creating space for him so that they can essentially rat up top lane with the Broodmother and get her webs down, get a continuous pressure on the jungle and on the tier 2 tower, and Anti-Mage can rat down bottom and force down the bottom, efficiently farming with that Battle Fury and then back off really quickly. So I think this throws Void Boys for a little bit of a loop. They know what the lanes are, essentially. Lina and Leshrac are pretty interchangeable as far as who's going to be going where. But you know that Anti-Mage is going to be bottom, Broodmother is going to be top. One of the Leshrac and the Lina is going to be supporting, and the other one in the solo mid. But in the end, just because you know the lanes doesn't mean it's going to be easy to deal with it. They go for the Earthshaker, so I think that's a pretty strong position for them to be in. But they switch up who's going to be actually running on the support Gyrocopter. Unless they swap, Fly is more confident on the Earthshaker. Zhuon is going to be supporting on the Gyrocopter. And that's going to be pretty interesting, I think. So mid Zeus, off lane Nyx, and safe lane Bristleback, as you'd pretty much expect out of this. But we'll see what those supports can do. Gyrocopter and Earthshaker working together on this one. And TC's going to take the Leshrac to the mid lane. So kind of a similar build to what you were looking at before. Maybe instead of the Aghanim Scepter, he picks up a Bloodstone. Goes Bloodstone, Octarine, BKB, aghanims, that kind of thing. Mobility is really important too, so you could see a blink, a force, or a BOTs on him as well, but no matter what the case, he's looking pretty good to be in this game here. And let's go ahead and go through some introductions for those that are less familiar with these fellas. So, we're going to be looking at the side of Root on the Radiant. Going to be having Fluff and Stuff supporting with the Boots first Lina. Anti-Mage will be played by Mu here with his 8 Tangos. Jason is going to be running that Shadow Demon, so going to have a pretty good time looking for the early disruptions here. Playing the 5 position too, actually buying up most of the consumables here. TC is actually opening with a Magic Wand versus the Zeus, so obviously the Magic Wand did get buffed in terms of stats. And it still only costs 465, so getting that extra attribute as well as potentially 17 charges instead of the 10 of the magic stick just gives him that much more potential against the Arc Lightning coming in from 747. Anyways, that's going to leave us with our top line here. Monkeys Forever already dropping his first web of the game. Get those charges rolling, and we'll see where he gets them down. For now, a ward here, a web here. So essentially, he wants to force out a sentry onto this part of the map and still have good vision here. There is a sentry that would kind of give vision of a lot of the web, but it's very unlikely to be placed there. It's much more likely to be placed slightly on the lane, and obviously if they're looking to do where they place it much more over here. So the idea is a two-pronged aspect where no matter what, he gets something out of this position. That said though, maybe Zeus gets a wandering lightning bolt sometime as he rotates. But for now, Siouan with 2 sentry wards, we'll see what he can do. Boundary runes, one went to Zeus, one went to Lesh, so that standard mid matchup you'd expect, but already having the healing salve up for TC is actually pretty strong for him. Zeus, on the other hand, 1 clarity, no mangoes, actually, on the Zeus. I think Zeus is probably one of the few mid laners that really benefits from having mangoes, but right now we see 4 on the field, not a single one in these mid laners' hands. So we've got 1 on the Broodmother, just in case she needs that extra bit of spawn spiderling action to kill somebody off before the Soul Ring comes out. Then we've got 2 on the Nyx Assassin. I already talked about the HP regen factor. If he gets harassed, I'll point it out, but any right clicks coming in against him, he can just shrug off and heal right back up. So Jason's not even bothering. But here you have 5 HP regen. Look at his health bar. It's going right back up. If he's out of combat, it's like he has a Heart of Tarrasque built into his hero. And he's got that stout shield too. We will see the Sentry Ward placed here by Siouan. It is... Actually, it did take some damage here, but it didn't go down. Monkeys Forever didn't actually use his Tango to eat it. He just tried to right-click it down. So, Nyx Assassin getting a little bit forward in this lane, but there is going to be a pull-through to try to deny a lot of these creeps, and it's going to be a triangle pull from Fluff and Stuff. Very practiced in this jungling mechanic, so he's going to hit the timing perfectly, and that's going to pretty much negate this entire Radiant creep wave. So, very good movement from him, and very frustrating for the offlane Nyx Assassin. Fly is also down here. It looks like he's going to go for a Fissure Block across the lane to make up for the fact that this lane's been pulled back so far and he is completely cut off from the creeps. But he doesn't go for it. He actually just says, okay, well, best of luck, buddy. And these creeps are probably going to stay right here as long as Mu goes to control them as best he can. Interesting. As it stands, though, the Broodmother really hasn't gotten anything out of this lane. Only level 1 right now. And Nyx Assassin, I mean, doing okay, at least. I mean, he's going to be able to get this next creep wave, it looks like. Money to burn. There's a bounty rune picked up by the Lina. Haste rune will sit top for a moment here. And let's look at last hits. We're going to see 12 and 4, the Bristleback up on the top lane. His stats may be inflated a little bit this game as far as how many spiders he ends up killing here with the quill sprays. The Leshrac is sitting at 12 and 3, so winning out mid lane at least for the moment here. And that's looking pretty good for him with this Haste rune now picked up. 747's not doing too bad at 10-0, but it's really difficult for Azuz to deny here with the lack of attack damage, the lack of attack animation, all these different factors. And Monkeys Forever, I think he's trying to go for last hits, but he's not connecting with them. The Spiderlings are coming out really slowly. The projectile isn't all that fast, so he's essentially wasting that skill, getting no spiders, getting no last hits. I mean, he wants the Soul Ring very clearly, and he's using his damage to try to get it, but it seems like he's maybe a little unpracticed on this hero. There is an opening here to go for the Nyx Assassin with the Disruption, but unfortunately he does have the Spike Carapace skilled, so although they'll probably be able to land with a few points of damage, he'll heal it up and he'll still reflect at least 1 or 2 nukes. Seeing a duel back and forth here in the mid lane. Bottle coming out for TC. He can go right back onto Zeus here. It's only the Earthshaker that could keep Susie alive if 747 actually got hit by that lightning storm. But since it didn't bounce back to him, he's doing okay. And we look back up top where Monkeys Forever digs further into the tree line with this web here. No sentries up and available for the gyrocopter. Expended one here, expended one here. And he finally gets a spider spawn, but does it really matter? I don't know. He's still going to be as slow of a soul ring as ever. And he's already used his mango. So I am a little bit surprised here. I mean, the spider will do some damage and frustrate the gyrocopter a little bit. But all in all, I think Monkeys Forever is trying to last it with these spiderlings. And they do 75 damage, but so far it's all been denied. Banner Rune coming out for TC. Going to bottle up that nicely. He's going to be hitting level 6 very quickly here. And I do hope he actually looks for that ultimate skill point. Now we see a very low HP Zeus. Tang going up. He's going to pick up a regen rune. Try to make the most of this one. Zeus with a regen rune is a very scary thing. He's got a lot of spells to work with here. Can keep spreading them out on a low cooldown. And mana is really no longer an issue. So that's pretty nice. Second last hit for Monkeys Forever. Going to be having that soul ring out pretty soon. And in the meantime, up top, or down bottom, it's just these supports are so defensive. Like, the offlaners in general just can't be killed easily. But we're going to see at least some good damage coming in. He'll spike Carapace. That will knock both Jason and Fluff off the Tunt. And that's going to be just the Nyx Assassin to heal it right back up. One Tango with these Mangos gives him 12.3 HP per second. Just insane. They really just can't zone him out. They cannot kill him. And this is also costing the supports because they're not pulling right now. This is a 5-13 wave they would normally be pulling, but they're so intent on zoning him back off the creep wave that it costs them that actual independent source of golden experience. Meanwhile, we're going to see Fly and Huon go in for the next play, and we'll see if they can connect with anything. They have level 1 Fisher, but they do have level 2 Rocket Barrage and the missile, so I think they could actually find a kill here. We'll see the opening. Looking in, they actually get the disruption offensively, but it's a bait as Jason is going to be taking a lot of damage here, and that Impale is going to net them the first blood. Now, the homing missile was on the Shadow Demon, so they won't be able to fall through for a second kill, but still, Zeus getting evolved, and Gyrocopter claiming the first blood. Very nicely done. In the meantime, though, that does mean that Monkeys Forever gets a 1v1 against the Bristleback. He has Dust, so if Monkeys Forever mans up a little bit too hard with low HP, then he'll be able to really manipulate that. But we actually look down bottom where there's going to be a Earthshaker caught out in the Lightstrike Array combo. Nice damage coming in from that Soul Catcher, and that's going to be enabling them to find a kill here. So, solid opener. Good response. Not the first blood they were looking for, but still at least something sweet. And again, it takes them away from the Broodmother. So Brood actually gets some space up here. Suddenly, she jumps up from 2 last hits up to 12. Monkeys Forever now controlling the jungle, farming up a little bit, and intending to move these spiders around as best she can. Now we see disruption onto Zeus. Bad spot to go for the Rune. Our low 1 stun will not connect. They only need 1 to do so, and they'll combo it up nicely. So great pickup on the Zeus, and yeah, we see that early point in the Pulse Nova from TC. A very value point at this point. And Mana Break against Omega Poner frustrates him. That's one thing that won't grow back easy. His health regen is absolutely insane for a bug, but the mana regen kind of lackluster, and he's going to have to Mango out his next stun. He's already eaten one Mango, now looking for a second one. There's the Mana Break, the homing missile connecting though, and just trying to lock them in place. If they connect with any stun here, they can follow it up with the Fisher and with the Mango Impale, and they'll go for it. Fisher's there. Now the Mango Impale, right-clicking, but a beautiful Light Strike Array gets Mu out. So they waste the Mango for nothing, and that's going to be Fluff just saving Mu's life. Mu will just jump out, heal back up. And we see up top here a little bit of frustration for the Bristleback. Does some good damage, too, as the Broodmother Spiders do get caught out here, but not really going to be that much back and forth. Man, Bristleback's farming up nicely, and the Broodmother's having trouble really putting pressure out on the Bristleback solo. Any other carry would probably be having a lot of issues here, but the Bristleback's pretty good for it. So, Dire trying to find an opportunity here. The Void Boys maneuvering, posturing 4v2, but looks like they're not willing to dive the tower, and that's the difference between a successful gank and just wasting time. Meanwhile, still good farm coming out for Mercy Police. He goes for the Vanguard early, so there's absolutely no way that Monkeys Forever harasses the Bristleback at this point. Like, maybe he can waste a little bit of his mana and force him to chew through a Mango, but Throw's actually getting good damage on him. It's not possible. We do see Fly. Lightning Storm is going to be coming in range pretty soon. Fly cannot outrun the Leshrac, but he does get to the river, and they know that he's got some kind of coverage from reinforcements. Meanwhile, down bottom, Megaponer, no Mangos, no Clarities, just automatic completely as Moo starts to control this lane. So we're seeing a bit of a mirror match, where essentially the offlaners who are meant to really disrupt things on the offlane are not able to do their jobs for one reason or another, and this gives Moo a pretty good position to farm, whereas Bristleback, of course, always had this advantage in the lane. Broodmother, though, is she looking for just a straight Midas? Monkeys Forever going and saving up 1,800 gold. Nice catch out on the Zeus here. Starting off with the disruption, that's all you need to do. If the Shadow Demon catches you, you die. That's the bottom line for the Zeus. Try as you might, there's only the Fissure and the Impale to save you, and those have to be pretty preemptive. I'm going to see Bristleback actually going past the tower a little bit here, just to use the Quill Sprays. Use the ability to kind of gradually push down these towers. He's got the Vanguard, so not really worried about his health, and in a pretty good position, just keep pushing through. And there is a little bit of lag, as you guys can see. A little stutter step here and there for the players. Broodmother does go for the Hand of Midas, though. The Centaur is a juicy treat for Monkeys Forever to transmute up. That's going to give him a lot of experience. And he really wants to go for that level 16 quick. Getting up that pretty much free Satanic, extra durability, and of course sniping the experience away from the Bristleback is fun too. And Mercy Please, if you're in range of the neutral creeps, you get a share of the experience. That's just a general rule that was implemented, I think it's 6.79. But Midas overrides that by saying, okay, well, no matter what, if a creep is Midas, it gives all that experience over to the bear 2.5 times over. So in this case, it takes it away from the Bristleback, it gives it to the Broodmother, and he just expands his web network. So he goes ahead, he goes further into the Dire Jungle, and the Bristleback, yeah, you can have free farm on the lane, but I'm still going to be the dominant force here on the northern part of the map. Smoke coming out from Gyrocopter and Earthshaker, but only level 2 on Fly. So this is actually not going to be a very powerful Fissure at all. 1 second duration stun and 125 damage. That might not even be enough to kill TC, who's looking to stack his creep cams right now. Very predictable movement, but despite the smoke flank, they actually just can't kill him. Xuan loses the smoke of deceit. Still hidden, but unable to really take aggressive action unless TC goes to farm. And he didn't get that stack, so he's still going to look to Soul Ring, Split Earth, and Lightning Storm that down. And that's the best chance. Locking him in with the Fissure is going to work now. Going to connect, but on the other side. They're going to try to follow through with Rocket Barrage, but it seems like it's too late. TC moving away, bottling up. They do snag a creep or two, but that is not the game plan there. So, early golden experience. State of the game shows that it is going to be about 4,200 net worth and 5,000 experience in advantage for Root Gaming right now. So, making good movements. If you look at just the top three net worth besides the Bristleback, you're seeing the Brood, the Anti-Mage, the Leshrac, all three cores doing some real work. And this is an advantage compared to the Zeus. If you look at just the Leshrac and Zeus, you're comparing a hero with only 3,500 net worth to one that's over 5,000. Now Fluff getting caught out here, they dive deep, they find themselves a nice kill, and they get a few heroes some much needed experience. Because looking at levels again, the Earthshaker is still level 3 in a world of heroes that are pretty much all level 6. Shadow Demon's a third of the way there.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
I'm going to look for an opening on the Bristleback here. He's pretty far forward, but he, as mentioned, is also very tanky. So going in with the ultimate here, a little bit of Encamp might do, but they're going to go in with Soul Catcher, Split Earth on top of the Disruption. Turning your back will not be enough to save you here. Bristleback goes down, a critical kill, and pushes them over the edge. They're really going to be building momentum now. I mean, that Shadow Demon, like I said, he's pretty much at his ultimate now. That Demonic Purge is so good against a number of these heroes, and as mentioned, this Earthshaker, he's not even level 4. This is a tough game. But we'll see. Nick's making his move, Vendetta-ing after he makes his TP complete. So he gives a little bit more mana to the Earthshaker via Arcane Boots, but you have to remember you can Vendetta when your TP is active. It doesn't break the channel. So he could have done that in the Fountain. Buys himself a couple extra seconds. Might be the seconds he needs to find the Broodmother, but it looks like Monkeys Forever is playing it too careful. Away from the tower. safe from Omega Poner. And at this point, the jungle is his. I mean, he just has full control, full dominance over this part of the map, and the Midas comes off cooldown just for this Dark Troll Summoner or Wild Wing to be claimed. I think the Dark Troll Summoner gives a little bit more experience, but it doesn't really make too much of a difference here. The Wild Wing's still a juicy treat, and without the negative 3 armor aura, you can farm these that much better. Even maybe force some skeletons out. So, scouting things out, they see the two stunners way in the wings. They're going to just seed this tier 1 tower, it looks like. They fortify it for now for free, but I don't think they're going to be able to deny that, so they will just have to let it go. And with that, Mercy Police looking to claim it with the next hit, and there it goes.
Radiant's top tower has fallen.
So, very passive. 4-2 at 14 minutes. Not the tempo of the game that I'm used to at this point, but 6.84, you guys have not yet seen the death ball. Oh my, I've been casting a little bit of Vici Gaming here, the patent creators of Death Ball, and I gotta say, it's coming, and it's gonna be coming strong. We're gonna be seeing some, 20-minute Dota. I still think that this patch has enough variability, though, that we will see some turtle strats that can actually trump Death Ball strats. It's just about timing and finding that comeback. Jason and Viz gonna scout out here against the Nyx Assassin. They do have detection. They have the Sentry Ward down, so starting off with the Demonic Purge, but Brood on the other side has to wait to be inside the webs in order to climb over the Fissure, and then she can go in for the aggressive play. But here we see Jason pretty much run down 1v3. Nowhere to go. Just trying to create some space. In the meantime, Bristleback, what are you going for with an Ogre Club here? Very interesting decision. I mean, obviously, their Sanji and Yasha is a pretty standard item for a one-position Bristleback nowadays, considering Illidan used to build it all the time in his carry Bristle, but I really think BKB would probably be too early. Like, I don't think it's a bad item this game, but I don't think it's an item you want before the 20-minute mark either. Vendettaing the smoke, trying to find that opening, but there's nobody here. There's only the Antimage. They see him, but they probably have doubts about their ability to kill him off. Moo here, farming the creep wave though, focus on getting each and every last hit, being as efficient as possible, and then suddenly the entire team comes out, stuns him, rocks his world, and the battle fury is delayed that much longer. Broodmother does get some space to push on this top tier 1, but overall I think the fact that the Antimage was just on the cusp of his battle fury pickup does make it a bit of a sour grape for him.
Dire's top tower is under attack. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
So we're going to look at the current items, and we actually already see TC picking up a Bloodstone. That is really impressive. Disassembling his Arcane Boots into the Bloodstone here, 16 minutes in. He gets the 8 default charges, and he looks to snowball from there. And I feel like TC has really been practicing these heroes, because if you look at his skill build, it just shows that he realizes the real potential for this. The Pulse Nova does not have to be maxed out, guys. It only does 30 more damage per second for double the mana cost per second. So if you just want to run around with your Pulse Nova on, keep it at level 1, and that's going to be the most efficient way to do it. I'm not saying that he won't max out his Pulse Nova, I'm just saying that before the Bloodstone was not the time for it. Now he's got his max Split Earth, his maxed Lightning, looking at maxed, near maxed Edict, and he'll get Pulse Nova immediately thereafter. So I think this just shows that TC has really shown, learned these new heroes in this new meta. He's been practicing a lot. He's been he's ready for the TI5 qualifiers. Their Root did slip into that one, and I'm looking forward to see how they perform, especially after we've seen them here today. Mercy Please, popping the Enchanted Mango, has plenty of mana to work with here, but we'll see them maybe make their move against him. Delicious Mango. It tastes so sweet, but now it only knows pain. We're going to see the Disruption come out onto Mercy Please. No, the TP's coming in. They bait them out, but Omega Poner now coming in with a great combo stun. The Mana Burn isn't much, but the Suicide comes out, and the first action with a Bloodstone being a Suicide is generally a pretty bad sign. Better than giving that momentum up, the fact that you are we're a 0-0-3 hero, you don't want to feed that away, but all the same, it is a sad day when you do get caught out like that, and that was a great reaction from Void Boys. Just immediately seeing the threat, popping the Thunder God's Wrath, and making the rotations as needed. Looked like Omega Poner was actually already there, so good movement from him with that Vendetta play. Again, I'm not so sure about the Spike Carapace, though. The fact that he's going to be maxing that out is a little bit odd for me. We're going to see TC finish off the tower here. He is going to just be hanging around farming. He will bring down the Gyrocopter, almost brings down the Earthshaker too, but He's fighting 1v4. Now Omega Pwner caught in the combo, but Jason unable to get more Shadow Poison out against the Nyx. Earthshaker will drop down as well, but not going to fall here. So, yeah, the Leshrac was just farming there. The tower was already dead. I assumed he was just trying to clean up the tower and got caught out, but that's been down for a little while now, guys. So, just an odd position for him to be in with everybody missing on the map, and maybe not respecting the Nyx Assassin's invis so much. This is as good as a ganking force as any when it comes down to this stage of the game, and they have to be wary about being in the open battlefield, being in the jungle, away from their towers. Dagon coming out from the Broodmother. This is the jungle dominance build. Just trying to find out anybody who's squishy enough to try to farm this jungle and force them out of it directly. For example, 747 right here trying to farm up. Lightning will give him vision, it looks like. Monkeys Forever still wants to try to make the play happen. Centaur stomps immediately. If he spreads his webs out to the east, he should find a very low HP Zeus that could just be Dagoned and Spiderlinged, but he's not seen it just yet. So he goes back to doing his thing, and he's going to rank up the Dagon. So it looks like it's going to be Dagon 5 Ethereal Blade from the Broodmother. It's not just, sometimes you actually just see a Dagon 1, because that's the big jump, is getting 400 from 0. But in this case, he's going to be maxing out. He's going to be looking to dominate the entirety of the jungle, and he's going to be looking pretty good doing it. In the meantime, this means that they have to send more than just one hero top at a time to deal with this Broodmother. The Bristleback can do it solo, but it also means he's kind of out of the game otherwise. Like, he actually can't get involved with what's happening in the mid and bottom lane. So Broodmother's here, and the Bristleback therefore is forced to remain. That just gives the opportunity for Root to take a 4v4 engagement that generally speaking favors them. We're gonna see the dust come out on the Broodmother, so I'll keep her click so you guys can see the action, but we see action down bottom as that Laguna Blade connects. Jason might be hit. Yeah, he'll die to Thunder God's Wrath, and they'll pursue onto Qon. Meanwhile, the Broodmother, as we saw, just taking hits, racking up that viscous nasal goo with the dust, and he will bring her down. So good ability to just stay on top of her, and makes it a 2-for-1 across the map in favor of Void Boys. Hakadim's Scepter already coming out for the Zeus. I was just looking at the Zeus and talking about how underfarmed he was, how far behind Leshrac was, but because he actually rushes Ags post Arcane Soul Ring, it's 7,300 net worth, it's still 7,300 net worth. You find yourself a good item, and we'll see just how much damage it can do. Bumping it up from 350 to 540. 190 magical damage increase across the map. Mitigated a little bit more by the spell shield than anything else, but still a pretty solid pickup. And TC starting to lose momentum a little bit here. He was looking so good this game, but at this point, he really just needs to find some opportunities. The Shadow Demon needs to set him up a little bit, and they need to go for just really big pickups. But it's hard to do without the Yule Scepter on Fluff. He's still building that one and should have it in just 300 gold. That's for me. And since absolutely nothing is going on otherwise, I actually like this play a lot. Void Boy's going in for the Roshan here. Able to bring that down pretty quickly. The negative armor from Viscous Nasal Goo. Actually, you don't have to get a third point in Goo to pick it up. He does have 3 points in Goo, though, and he will be subtracting 1.8 armor per stack. And that actually adds up to -7 armor against the Roche there. So they take it down pretty quickly with minimal pain, and they get the Aegis up on the Bristleback. So he's going to start to man fight. Does cost them a lot of HP on this tower. Might even cost them the tower itself as Broodmother commits to it. But yeah, they don't even fortify it. It just goes down. But that's okay, because they get the Roshan for the Tier 1 against a Broodmother who's going to be pushing that tower anyways whenever you leave that lane. So they give that away as an option, and now they go in for the heavy push with this Aegis. Mercy Please can stay on the front line to Kingdom Come because he's got that extra life. He's got tons of HP to work with, and he wants to be the linebacker here. Looking at the current gold graph, we're going to be seeing closer to 7,000. Gold in favor of the Root Gaming. Kind of tapering their advantage here. They only have about 8,500 experience ahead. Mercy Play is going to be going down for the first time here, but Thunder God's Wrath already shown what it can do against the lowly support Lina, and immediately TC has to suicide. So, yeah, road to zero Bloodstone charges indeed, chat. 4 Bloodstone charges remaining here on the Leshrac. It's not looking good for TC. He's got the Glimmer Cape now, so he can withstand a lot more damage, but as a whole, it's just a kind of a Band-Aid fix. It's not actually putting him back in the game. We do see, however, Monkeys Forever is going to find the gyrocopter, kill him off nicely with the Dagon Spiderlings, and take the tier 2 tower. So while all that fighting was going down, and while the Zeus ulti set up 2 kills very nicely, it's still the Broodmother to get the better end of the exchange. She gets a tier 1, she gets a tier 2, she gets to build up her Dagon to level 5. And the best part about Dagon 5 is the cooldown, actually. It's not just the damage. Actually, if you do the math on it, the damage is really crappy. Because you're building up 100 points for each recipe. Each recipe costing 1250. So it's like, you spend 125 gold per... Did I do that wrong? No, I did it right. Yeah, You spend 12.5 gold, yeah, for 1 point of magical damage. And it's just not the most efficient trade. But you do get extra stats with each increase, and most importantly, the cooldown is now 15 seconds. So able to spam that out multiple times over, short cooldowns, but first and foremost, they're going to use this Gem of Truesight to jump on top of her and bring her down. So while she might have some offensive momentum, she just got picked off, she lost all her spiders, and yeah, they're going to start controlling this top lane. Meanwhile, poor support Gyro having a really hard time of things, and TC glimmering around will find that opening for Lina to get the kill. So they go ahead, they commit the Lugana Blade and the Demonic Purge, and 420 damage from the Leshrac as well.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
So, but we're going to be looking at this Anti-Mage, and all the while we're talking about here is like Broodmother and Leshrac, one aspect is clear. Anti-Mage has been farming. Anti-Mage has been ignoring fights. He's only gotten one kill this entire game of the 8 they've claimed in 24 minutes, and he has been focusing on the creeps. 230 last hits is Mu on the Anti-Mage, and he is actually going to be finding himself not only the Battle Fury, but the Vlads and soon-to-be Mantis style here in just a few minutes. And that's really when this hero gets involved. When he sees that opportunity where he's like, yeah, I've got that going for me. Now I can break into three, go for the triple mana break, and follow that up with the Void. And the Zeus in particular is going to be very vulnerable to that. Because he didn't go for Force Staff, he didn't go for Ghost Scepter, he went for nothing but this offensive build. And while it's cool to have an Aghanim Scepter as your first item, and go follow it up with maybe like a Bloodstone or an Octarine Core, in reality, Anti-Mage is going to take extreme advantage of that. He's just going to go right on top of the Zeus every fight, burn all his mana, and pop goes the weasel with that Void. But we'll see. For now, he's still got to farm that Mantis style, and we do see this Smoke Blade coming out here on the sidelines. Three turtling inside their base, the Fisher not finding much as far as pickoff openings, and Mu just says, okay, well, I'll just keep farming then. I've got this TP ready, but we don't really have to draw the line just yet. It looks like he even wants to creep cut the next wave, which would be interesting. I mean, maybe he's sniping a courier, but more likely he's looking for a flank now. We're going to see Jason actually walk away from this, going in, getting all of his spells off here. He does waste the Demonic Purge, but nevertheless, good movement there, wasting the Nyx Assassin's life, and the gem picked up by the Bristleback. Now he's got to live, but the Dagon says, no, sir, you're going down, and Mu TP's in, gets the Mana Void, brings down that Shaker, and is going to pursue onto the Gyrocopter, fast as he may be, with the Yule Scepter. The Tranquil Boots are broken, the Incap Bite locking him down, and he will fall. So, Voidblade's just trying to force the issue before this Anti-Mage got to his next item, but it's too late already. They actually just straight up lose their lives, and now the bottom tower, getting right-click down, should be glyphed. There are four dead people looking at this die. There are four people looking and having nothing better to do than glyph a tower, at least delaying 5 seconds on Anti-Mage's farming time. But they don't use their free glyph, and, I don't know, they get a ticket. 10,000 net worth in favor of Root, 14,000 experience. Void Boys seem to be a little frustrated with the current state of affairs. They were doing really well in the laning stage. I feel like they had a lot of momentum built up underneath them. The Zeus was doing poorly, unfortunately, but at least the Bristleback was getting good free farm. But what has that actually gotten them? A Sanji and Yasha, a Vanguard, and most of a BKB. That's not really carry the game on your shoulders Bristleback items. AC Heart, maybe. Radiance I've even seen. But SNY Vanguard, not so much. So, if you're just looking at straight up net worth, it's suddenly the Anti-Mage is all the way up there at 15.3k. The top three net worth are Root Gaming members. They're looking to practically 2-0 Void Boys. And right now, they can't even get into their jungle to farm. We're going to see a quick jump here. Dagon And, no Spiderlings. He didn't actually use the Spiderling, thought that the Spiders would do it himself, and they actually just get farmed up. Oh, boy. That's a bit of a misplay. Moki's forever. We end up seeing the Gyrocopter walk away with 100 HP and get a ton of last hits. They won't show the gold for the last hits, but I think that all of those went to the Gyrocopter. No matter who got it, somebody on Void Boys got a full army of Spiders inside the cooldown with that AoE. Could have been a Zeus Static Field, I don't know. But it was some really good damage, and that was just Broodmother feeding her life away in a pretty easy kill opportunity, and of course feeding the Spider army away as well. Very, very sad. And there's a little dip in the graph to show how sad we are. So, we're going to be looking at, now that the Yule Scepter is completely done, Fluff, he wants to go for the Aghanim Scepter, really mess with his Gyro, not the Gyrocopter, anybody who's looking to carry a BKB this game, which so far is just the Bristleback, so we'll see how that plays out. Yeah, along with that, we're seeing a casual point booster on the Zeus before he goes for, instead, the Refresher Orb. So the Refresher Orb does not require anything other than just Perseverances. And he's going to be going for that next. So it seems like the point booster is just to kind of throw them for a loop as far as it could be an Octarine Core. As well as, of course, just give him some casual stats to pad while he builds up his next big item. And there's going to be the Heart coming out for the Anti-Mage. At that point, it's going to be very difficult to deal with him. Generally speaking, you like to look at Zeus and say he's a good counter to high HP heroes because he has this ability called Static Field, and based on a percentage of their current health, he gets magical damage sent out. But you look at this Anti-Mage, and he's got his spell shield maxed out. He has 62% magical damage resistance, and that factor doesn't really affect him too directly. So they're going to go for the smoke play here, look for their opportunity perhaps against the Broodmother. Detection is just a Sentry Ward. Just Dust, just Sentries, there's the Thunder God's Wrath, and they will not connect with the Impale. Mookus Forever just outrunning them, waiting for his webs to kick back in. He will be dusted, but without damage against him, he goes into the trees, he BOTs away. Oh boy. That's unfortunate. Losing the smoke, losing the dust, losing a Sentry Ward, and the Zeus ulti too. They force Mookus Forever out of the web work, but still in a pretty good position to farm up the map. And meanwhile, we see TC actually bouncing back a decent bit too. Gets the BOTs for himself to fix those mobility problems. Still glimmering as always, and now looking for a point booster item pickup. Could be that Octarine. And of course, as we talked about, Anti-Mage pretty much at the Heart level. He's got the Reaver and the Recipe, just needs a Vip booster, and then he goes ahead and is able to kind of just start pushing tier 2s directly. Mookus Forever has been ratting it out pretty well. Now they might go for another play against him. Radiant, do not see this Nyx Assassin. This Nyx is in Vendetta. So Mega Poner, sneak attack, coming in from the sideline here with the dust. And this is going to be their opening, if any at all. Oh, the Anti-Mage farming under the ward too. Where do they go? They see two good targets. They need to get one of them. But it looks like they're not finding anything. Anti-Mage here in the jungle. Broodmother on the lane. They'll go for the Broodmother. They will stun her out. And they will get that kill. So very nicely done. Getting the opening there to get the Impale off and killing off the Broodmother, as you can see. So, 943, the Vendetta did connect there. In the meantime, the Lina did fall down. I'm trying to... I guess it was just the Urshaker Echo Slam. Yeah, he blinks, Echo Slams her on the creep wave, and they're able to clean her up with just that on the cooldown. And the Golden Experience holds steady at 12,000 and 15,000, but I think this Heart is a bit of a game changer. Moo now going to be so survivable that he can just move all over the map and pretty much be fearless. I feel like he can start directly pushing tier 2s without too many repercussions. And TC now is going to get caught out a little bit here. He's not even using the Pulse Nova, doesn't want to get hit by that Spike Carapace immediately. Moo comes in to help him out, and a nice defensive disruption buys him time. But in the end, TC still will fall. They turn it to be a 2-for-1, and they're going to go for more. Nice damage is coming in from Moo, and the Illusions are still tanking up a few spells here. So they're actually going to be able to Laguna down the Zeus, and the Anti-Mage will TP away. Self-Yules on the Lina. She wants to buy herself time. Actually, that was a Yules against her by the Gyrocopter, it seems. And in the end, Moo is perfectly fine. He walks away from that one. Heart regenning. And yeah, he got pretty directly involved. 2-for-1. The Broodmother was already dead, so they killed the Leshrac. And they kill the Earthshaker and the Zeus. But Overall, good involvement from the anti-mage, finally coming online, coming into his own, and going right into the pit. At this point, they just say, screw it, give TC an Aegis, get him online that way, and I can see some real value in having that second life on him, so... Gonna be in a good position here to just start taking fights offensively, but it looks like Void Boys don't want to give them the Roche without a fight. 20 seconds on the Echo Slam, though. It's got to be a really good Fissure, because that's all Roshicker has to offer. They do lock a couple in the pit here. Gonna get some close spray damage out. Monkeys Forever now outside the web, but BOTing to a little spider is TC coming into this one, ready to go with a lot of magic damage. Mu will run out of mana, run low on life, but Monkeys Forever dueling out with Mercy Please on the sideline here, and one more hit will bring him down. No, they can't finish him off. Mercy Please walks away. Fly is left to Echo. Right click. Bring down the Brood. And that's going to be it for now. Omega Poner still hunting. Has a gem. Has his Vendetta. But at least for now, they do seem to see him. They have a gem on their own side on the Lina. Buyback coming in from the Earthshaker. Again, they want this Roche pit. They want it badly. So they're going to go in, commit to it looks like. And problem is, they don't have a heart on their core. Mercy Please. He's not regenerating that much HP. If he's committing to this, he's doing so very haphazardly. So they get some good bashes, they get the Viscous Nasal Goo stacking up, and Root are still down that Broodmother. That was a pretty critical pickup there by the Shaker. So, Fly making the plays happen, and they go in with this buyback to bring down the Roche. Now, the gold won't be coming in for Fly. He does have the buyback gold penalty, but Mercy Please will pick up the Aegis, they'll get that bounty, and they'll take it to the bank. We'll see what they can do with it. So really not much happening at the moment here. We're just kind of seeing a little bit of Ward Wars action, but these are not long for this world if the gems stay on either side. Alina has a gem, Nyx has a gem, so it's very likely that Omega Poner will find that one shortly, and yeah, we're not going to see as much advanced vision coming out, at least not on the ground level. The plateaus and such still have some opportunities to keep those gems alive, but as it stands right now, I think the Void Boys are just kind of looking to control the map piece by piece. And the Brood has to play it safe now. Like, this is completely different than the position she was at earlier. She's breaking down her webs on the top. She's sending them out down bottom with these charges, allowing her to spin her web further and further to the north. And she'll look towards this bottom tier too. But more so, her gameplay style has to change just because she is playing up against a Gem of Truesight. Until they wrench that from Nyx's Assassin, it's not going to be an easy thing. But Omega Poner, he may just be giving it away. Oh no! Getting caught out here. The gem hits the deck. And just scratch everything I just said about him playing differently. He doesn't have to worry about the detection, at least not at that level. The Gem of Truesight is a big factor in how easy it is to pick her off, and now they've got two in their hands, with Void Boys having none. Zeus will have that Refresher Orb soon, looking for it, but as it stands, he's still pretty far off of it, and TC will easily claim this Tier 2 tower. No chance they'll be able to pick that up. And it looks like they want one more pickup. Mercy Please has that medallion, but still trying to just kind of farm out and clear out these creep waves. Feels pretty confident in his health pool that he's going to be able to survive. And of course, if you bait them into trying to jump onto the Bristleback, they've got that Earthshaker ready for that creep wave. So he's going to look for the Echo Slam. Still, the Refresher Orb finally does come out for the Zeus. Two BOTs up top here, but... Void Boys scouting out with one ulti, making them think it's on cooldown, and then hitting them with the second one if the fight does actually come through. So, I'm wondering what the anti-mage goes for next. Presumably Butterfly is really good here, but, I mean, there's not that much direct right-click going up against him, so I could see him skipping it for something like an Abyssal Blade. I wonder if Moonshard is actually possible in his progression. Like, usually the heroes that farm as fast as possible that could actually afford an item like that aren't generally the best carriers for it because they usually run illusions. Animage does, in all fairness, run two illusions, but I still think his primary hero's right clicks matter quite a bit. And I think the Moonshard could enhance that quite a bit, so. After we see that first, that 7th slot come through, or that 6th slot, with the BOT's upgrade and the Vladimir's upgrade and of course the Abyssal Blade, I could definitely see him looking towards something like that Moonshard, and we'll see if that's something that benefits him very much. I mean, if you think about it, the Mana Break is a steroid that scales based on how many hits you deal out. That's why Mantis Style is really good, but in this case, attack speed could be just another valuable aspect of the hero, and plus 60 is definitely something to consider. So we'll see him look for that long term, but right now we're talking just the here and now, the present. We've got Abyssal Blade up on the Bristleback, and he is going to be looking to lock down a very specific target. Could go for the last track. We're going to see the Echo Slam come through right on the Anti-Mage, but it doesn't take all that much damage. He's got so much magic resistance, he just blinks away. They waste the Abyssal on an illusion. Oh my. Now the Rue can just go pedal to the metal, engage, and there's no cooldowns. They expended two ultimates for that. The Thunder God's Wrath, number one, along with the Echo Slam, and even the Abyssal Blade cooldown is quite substantial. So tier 2 should be going down in favor of Root very shortly, unless they play it very cautiously. Right now, though, they're smoking up. They're smoking right past the tower that's still there. They really want to find somebody in the trees, but it looks like they're not going to be there. TC glimmering forward. Smoke will break now, but he doesn't necessarily see the Zeus. In fact, the Zeus is the one scouting back his direction. So that timer is ticking down, and it looks like they won't be able to push off that. They will, however, catch Disruption onto the Bristleback, who just goes right onto Jason here. No Ghost Scepter, so he's going to be going down soon. Dust makes sure of it, and the right clicks finish him off. Now on the backside, it's going to be Mu doing some massive damage here. Good right clicks coming in. Good bashes too, but he wants to pick off the Chuan, and oh my, the Dagon will do just that. Now Suzy, the main target of choice for the Anti-Mage. He'll go right on top of him, gets the bash, will get the Mana Void kill, and that's going to do some damage to Mercy Please too. He'll be forced back, and that becomes a 4-for-1. Mu is in full carry mode right now. The fun ends here. He has finished farming. He is level 25, Abyssal online, going up to the high ground here. TC, going to be the frontliner for now. 11 Bloodstone charges, bouncing back from, I think, 4? So doing really well since then. And, racking up 3 kills and 11 assists. He's been very involved this game. And suddenly, just taking that golden experience advantage to the next level here. The Rax will fall. Mercy Please can do nothing about that. And in fact, he's going to get Abyssal. They're going to try to combo that up with the Lightstrike Array. Awkward to use the Yules for it, though. And his back is turned all the while, but he's out of mana, about to be out of life. That last bash, but he's still alive. He's going to go down. No, another bash. Are you kidding me? GGWP right off of that last bash. And that's going to be Void Boys calling it quits. Throwing in the towel. Root take it 2-0 here, guys. Thank you so much for tuning in to the MLG Pro League here. Thank you. I hope you guys enjoyed the commentary. I hope you enjoyed the games. But that's actually going to be it for a little while here. So, 2 wins for Root Gaming, the best of 3 in the books, and we're going to be going into the next match, I believe, with some delay. I'm not as familiar with the MLG's system, but I don't think we jumpstart into the next match. I think we go on schedule. So I'm going to go ahead and ask the admin just to make sure, and I'll let you guys know on the next screen. But for now, I think we're going to be looking at a 45-minute break before our next matchup, and then we're going to see some more MLG action here for the Pro League for Dota 2. Thanks for tuning in once again. I myself am Blaze, broadcasting on behalf of joinDOTA today. And if you enjoyed the commentary, look me up on my Twitter at BlazeCasting. You can follow me, you can flame me, critique me constructively. That'd be awesome. But no matter what, I hope you guys enjoyed. And I'll see you guys next time.